بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستهديه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه وسلم تسليما كثيرا مزيدا إلى يوم الدين. أما بعد، 2 weeks ago, in our last class, we stopped at the beginning, the first phrase of the first sentence in the third chapter. اعلم أرشدك الله لطاعته أن الحنيفية ملة إبراهيم. No, may Allah direct you to obedience to Him. أن الحنيفية ملة إبراهيم. No, may Allah direct you to His obedience. That الحنيفية is Millat Ibrahim. Before we go on any further on Millat Ibrahim, I wanted to make a couple more points. The first one is, why did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala emphasize to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to follow Millat Ibrahim alayhi salatu wa sallam? Even though Nuh and Isa and all the messengers of Prophets alayhi salatu wa sallam were on the pure Tawheed, Allah said, وَلَقَدْ بَعَثْنَا فِي كُلِّ أُمَّةِ الرَّسُولَ أَنَا نَعْبُدُ اللَّهُ وَاجْتَنِبُ الطَّاغُوتِ. Every one of them was on the pure Tawheed. Why did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala specify to Ibrahim, ثُمَّ أَوْحَيْنَا إِلَيْكَ أَنِ اتَّبِعْ مِلَّةَ إِبْرَاهِيمَ حَنِيفًا. He directed the messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to follow مِلَّةَ إِبْرَاهِيمَ حَنِيفًا. Why did he emphasize to follow مِلَّةَ إِبْرَاهِيمَ حَنِيفًا, not مِلَّةَ نُوح حَنِيفًا or مِلَّةَ عِيسَى حَنِيفًا or any of the other prophets and messengers? The core message of Tawheed, of pure Tawheed, was the common denominator among all of our prophets and messengers. The details may have been different, but the Tawheed of all the messengers was the pure Hanifiyya Tawheed. Now, why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in specific to follow Millat Ibrahim Hanifa? The answer is because when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to Mecca, nearly everyone in his vicinity was claiming to follow Millat Ibrahim. Quraysh, statue worshippers, were attributing themselves to Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam. The Jews were attributing themselves to Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam. The Christians were claiming to follow Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam and claiming that he's their father. Allah wanted to show that there was only one who was following him, the path of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. It was important to show at that time and for future times and generations until the judgment day that the path of Millat Ibrahim alayhi salam that everyone claims to follow is the path of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The second issue, and I'll divide it to A and B. The author said, أَنَّ الْحَنِيفِيَّ مِلَّةِ إِبْرَاهِيمِ. And if you look in your copies, you're not going to see alayhi salam or alayhi salatu wasalam anywhere there. That's if they, you know, some may have added it, but the original text does not have alayhi salatu wasalam. And in asking those who mastered the work of the author, rahmatullah alayhi, Ibn Abdul Wahhab, that those who mastered it said, one reason may be because it's not wajib, it's sunnah. But he may have some type of reason or assumed that the reader would say it. In Nawawi, rahmatullah alayhi, narrated that there's an ijma' consensus that just like we say alayhi salatu wa sallallahu alayhi wa sallam about the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we can say salah and salam on all the other messengers. Not meaning it's obligatory on all the other messengers, but the fact that we can say it about the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we can also give salah and salam on all the other messenger, meaning it's permissible. In fact, Ibn Hajar in Nawawi disliked for one to say salah on the prophets and messengers without added salam to it. Example like Ibrahim alayhi salatu wassalam. That's how they meant it should be. Instead of Ibrahim alayhi salam. The formal way is to say Ibrahim alayhi salatu wassalam. Ibn Hajar further commented on the dislike, and he said the disliking is for one who continuously says the shorter form and never ever says the other one. For example, one who always says alayhi salam, alayhi salam, alayhi salam about other prophets, but doesn't at times add alayhi salatu wasalam, the formal ways to say alayhi salatu wasalam. The other point we'll go over is that it relates to this, it's B, is about saying sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The mention of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in writing or saying, or in social media and saying sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We know we must say that. But what about in writing? Since it relates to this issue. When you do write or type, always write it out fully. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And say it fully. Don't abbreviate and don't shorten. When you're reading a book, don't just say it in your heart, because that's not considered saying. That's thinking. Once you utter it on your lips, whether silent or out loud, then it becomes saying. The point is write sallallahu alayhi wasallam fully. Don't abbreviate. Don't shorten. Ibn Salah rahimahullah, the alim, the giant of hadith and other sciences, but mainly of hadith. He died 643 years after the Hijrah in his book Al-Hadith wa Kayfiyat Dabtih, about a book that talks about manners and style of how to write hadith, how to document it, and how it was compiled, and matters related to that. He died 643 years after the Hijrah, back in the ink pot and feather era, not with lavish pens and keyboards to write, which take less than a second. He probably had to sink the feather in the ink pot several times to get through sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He said, speaking to students, don't get bored, don't ever get bored from writing sallallahu alayhi wa sallam fully, as many times as you mention him in your writing. He wants people to write it. He said, it's among the best and biggest early benefits students of hadith reap from their knowledge. He said that back in the days, because when there was only few who wrote, not many wrote. Many would mention hadith, but unlike these days, it was not many who wrote. So he was directing his talk to the students who wrote. So it applies really to anyone who writes. Everyone today writes. Today everyone uses social media. Everyone passes on hadith. It's widespread to text and write, unlike back in the old days. And that's how you see how giants became giants of hadith. Matters we consider nothing, they held in very high regard. PBUH or other abbreviations many use, or even saying sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has become a heavy thing on the tongues today. But to our imams and our salaf, they deemed that in high regard. And that's why Allah honored them. And that's why Allah blessed their lives. And that's why Allah blessed their knowledge. It's a sign of their taqwa. Whoever honors the symbols of Allah, then it's truly from the piety of the hearts. ذَلِكَ وَمَنْ يُعَظِّمْ شَعَائِرَ اللَّهِ فَإِنَّهَا مِنْ تَقْوَى الْقُلُوبِ. Ibn Salah said, writing sallallahu alayhi wa sallam fully is among the best and biggest early benefits students of hadith or ilm reap. Then he said, whoever neglects that has been deprived of something mighty. What are you talking about, Ibn Salah? What is that mighty thing? Right in sallallahu alayhi wasallam, fully. Subhanallah. Tells you how these imams became imam. Ibn Salah then said, we've seen that people who write it fully, every time his name is mentioned or written, they were people who had righteous dreams. Then he mentioned, what I really wanted to get at is, let not anyone use symbols nor abbreviations. He deterred people from using symbols or abbreviation. Hamza al-Kinani said, I used to write always sallallahu alayhi. Not PBUS or S or Saad or Lam Mim as they use in Arabic, abbreviate in Arabic. He said, I used to write the hadith and say sallallahu alayhi without wasallam. He said, then I seen in my dream that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam was telling me, why don't you finish it with sallam? And he said, I never ever wrote his name after that except I wrote it fully sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Ibn Salah went further to say it's also disliked to write alayhi salam about the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Write fully sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Sakhawi, who died 902 years after the Hijrah, approximately 500 years ago, still in the feather and pot era, in the book Fath al-Mughith fi Sharh Alfiyat al-Hadith al-Iraqi, he said a statement back then that it's as if he's talking to the ummah of today. He said, refrain from using abbreviations in your writing, such as using, he specifically said, two letters. Don't use the two letters abbreviation. Don't use no abbreviation. And he specifically said, don't be like the non-Arabic ignorance in how they abbreviate. He said, that's not our trend. That's a statement. And that's possibly, he was talking about probably the newcomers to Islam who he mentioned as Ajam. And they were probably abbreviating and he wanted to kill that trend back then. And then he said, write the full sallallahu alayhi wasallam instead of Saad, Saameem, or Saad, Lam, Ayn, Meem. That's diminishing your Ajr and not the best method. In Suyuti, in Tadrib al-Rawi, he said similar statements in disliking the abbreviation or shortening of sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Let me add to that more contemporary issues. If you're speaking or you're typing to a Muslim audience who speak English, use sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Use it, write it either in Arabic or maybe transliterate it in English. Transliterate the word in English. But in Arabic words, sallallahu alayhi wasallam, S-A-L-L-A-H, on and on. Meaning write sallallahu alayhi wasallam, not peace be upon him, or other transliterated statements. That would be the best way to do it. Now if the audience you're writing to or you're talking about may not understand what you're saying and it's for da'wah purposes, maybe you can put peace be upon him or another translated word for the purposes of telling him what you are saying or what it means or what we say about the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Now as to situations like Twitter where your characters are limited, or if you're in a lecture like here taking notes, you don't have time, you can't write it, it's best to utter the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam's full sallallahu alaihi wasallam and leave it out without no abbreviations. At least say it. Those who I mentioned are the biggest imams of Mustalah al-Hadith, all disliked abbreviations and shortening. So instead of abbreviating on Twitter, where you're desperate for characters, instead of promoting something that's disliked by the imams of Hadith, shortening and abbreviating, leave it out, but most definitely say it, and help revive the sunnah of, you know, writing it where you're able to fully, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Al-Khatib al-Baghdadi said, I seen in the handwriting of Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal some written work where he did not put, he put the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's name, but he did not put sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He said, but I was told that he verbally said it every time he read it. He probably did it for his own writing or his own note taking, maybe lack of ink or lack of time, like in lectures. he didn't put sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and he didn't abbreviate. That's my point. He didn't abbreviate as well. But what was important is that he would verbally say it. And this applies to like Twitter or like in classes like here where you rush it to write notes and they may not have time to say sallallahu alayhi wasallam. What's sad today is that not only do Muslims neglect typing it or writing it, sallallahu alayhi wasallam, but the saying of it has become abandoned. I give lectures sometimes and I look, or khutab, and you look at the audience, there's really rarely anyone saying sallallahu alayhi wasallam when you mention the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam's name. And I just remembered saying that, I just remembered the third issue, so make it C in your notes, which is, the ruling on saying sallallahu alayhi wasallam. So A was alayhi salatu wasalam about messengers, B was about shortening, abbreviating sallallahu alayhi wasallam in writing, and C would be, is it wajib to say sallallahu alayhi wasallam every time you hear his name or not? At-Tahawi and Al-Halimi said every time the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam's name is mentioned, it's wajib to say sallallahu alayhi wasallam, meaning you get sins for not saying it. Now other ulama, this is the disputed matter, other ulama said it's only wajib one time per setting. And there's a few other opinions in between that. It's sufficient for me and you to know that salah and the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam is ordered in the Quran. إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي يا الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما. O you who believe, give your salah and salam on the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Allah started with himself, then secondly mentioned the angels, then ordered the ummah to make salah on the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. It's sufficient to know the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said the stingy one is one who my name is mentioned and he doesn't say sallallahu alayhi wasallam. إِنَّ أَبْخَلَ النَّاسِ مَنْ ذُكِرْتُ عِنْدَهِ فَلَمْ يُصَلِّ عَلَيْهِ Sunan al-Tirmidhi, Musnad Ahmad. And more so, he made dua on those who his name is mentioned and they don't make sallallahu alayhi, they don't say sallallahu alayhi wasallam. رَغِمَ أَنْفُ رَجِلٍ ذُكِرْتُ عِنْدَهِ فَلَمْ يُصَلِّ عَلَيْهِ in Sunan al-Tirmidhi. May Allah smother his nose in dirt. Meaning, may Allah humiliate him. May he be humiliated. Who? One, my name is mentioned, he doesn't say sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Now let's move on to the next sentence. اِعْلَمْ أَرْشَدَكَ اللَّهُ لِطَاعَتِهِ أَنَّ الْحَنِيفِيَّ مِلَّةِ إِبْرَاهِيمِ أَنْ تَعْبُدَ اللَّهَ وَحْدَهُ مُخْلِصًا لَهُ الدِّينِ أَنْ تَعْبُدَ اللَّهَ وَحْدَهُ مُخْلِصًا لَهُ الدِّينِ وَبِذَلِكَ أَمَرَ اللَّهُ جَمِيعَ النَّاسِ وَخَلَقَهُمْ لَهَا. The next phrase, أَنْ تَعْبُدَ اللَّهَ وَحْدَهُ أَنْ تَعْبُدَ اللَّهَ وَحْدَهُ is that you worship Allah alone. To worship Allah alone. The reason why we were created, the reason why the universe was created, and why the messengers, alayhim salatu wasalam, were sent. وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسَ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ. Verily I created human and jinn to worship me. To worship me here, Ibn Abbas said, is tawheed. The true religion, Tawheed, the true religion, it's to worship Allah, making all of the religion purely for Allah. That's why, and Allah commanded the people of Tawheed, and ordered them to follow the path of Tawheed. وما أرسلنا من قبلك من رسول إلا نوحي إليه أنه لا إله إلا أنا فاعبدون. We did not send any messenger before you, O Muhammad, except that we revealed to him that none has the right to be worshipped except Allah. So make all of your worship purely for him. Pure. That's ibadah. Pure tawheed to Allah. First thing we'll take care of is the definition of ibadah. Linguistically, ibadah means lowliness or humiliation. In Arabic, you say tariqun mu'abbad, a street that's mu'abbad. It means a street that's been stepped on. Meaning humiliation, lowliness. But the shar'i meaning, we mentioned what shar'i meaning is many times, the shar'i meaning of ibadah entails both humility and love. worship, ibadah, in its general sense, is submitting oneself to Allah with love and awe. How? How? By doing that which He has ordered and avoiding that which He has forbidden in the manner laid down and prescribed by Him. Submitting oneself to Allah with love and awe by doing that which He has ordered and avoiding that which He has forbidden or prohibited in the manner laid down and prescribed by Him. Now, the specific meaning, definition of worship is like Shaykh al-Islam, the best definition you will see. Definition of Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah rahmahullah. He said, ibadah, worship, is a comprehensive term covering what Allah loves. It's everything Allah loves. And whatever He is pleased with. Whatever Allah loves, whatever Allah is pleased with. Both saying and actions. The apparent and the hidden. Such as fearing, having awe, paying zakah, fasting, and any other practices prescribed by Islam. That's the best and most comprehensive definition for ibadah. Salah, zakah, hajj, treating parents good, being dutiful to them, ordaining the good, forbidding the evil, da'wah, tawakkul. All of that is included in ibadah. Ibadah is everything that pleases Allah with pure niyyah and in accordance with the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the teachings of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. In Sahih Muslim, Abu Dharr, the hadith narrated by Abu Dharr, people came to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and the poor people said, the wealthy people get higher grades at the end because they spend a lot. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said at the end of the hadith, even sexual relationship, you will have reward for it. They said, we get reward for sexual relationship with our wives? He said, if you do it in haram, wouldn't you get sins? They said, yes. He said, and likewise, when you do it in halal, you get reward. So if one has the intention to have relationship with his wife, to preserve himself from haram, to have kids to benefit this ummah with, or to follow in accordance with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam teaching and to get married, he will get reward for that. We mentioned this in a little bit more detail in a previous class. You can refer to it. How regular day-to-day traditions can be transferred from traditions to ibadah. Like sleeping, like working out, if you remember. We specifically said those two. Ibadah is when Allah says, I order the person to do. He says, I hear and I obey. Heart, limbs, brains, and all of him submits totally and fully. That's ibadah. قُلْ إِنَّ صَلَاتِي وَنُسُكِي وَمَحْيَايَ وَمَمَاتِي لِلَّهِ رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ لَا شَرِيكَ لَهُ. Your eyes, your heart, your hands, your brains all submit to Allah, the one who ordered you to worship. The requisites of ibadah, the prerequisites of ibadah, is to do it for the sake of Allah. On the avenue of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The summary of the deen is to worship Allah as He wants. That can only come through the avenue of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Two principles, and the proof, the biggest proof you need for him is shahadatin. One who understands the shahadatin. First, la ilaha illallah, Allah. To do it for Allah. The second, Muhammad Rasulullah, is to do on the path of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. There are those who make that which is permissible haram. And what's haram? Permissible. Those who do that and those who follow them, that's one of the ways of having ibadah to other than Allah. You remember the hadith of Adi ibn Hatim when he heard the Prophet ﷺ reciting, اتخذوا أحبارهم ورهبانهم أربابا من دون الله. They've taken their rabbis and their monks as lords beside Allah. وَمَا أُمِرُوا إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُوا إِلَهًا وَاحِدًا. And they were only ordered to worship one Lord. When he heard that, to his mind, what was meant by worshiping is that it's bowing and prostrating to someone else, supplicating, sacrificing. That's what came to his mind. But the Prophet ﷺ informed him that their obedience to their rabbis and monks and forbidden that which is permissible and permitting that which is forbidden was a form of worship. Because they made their rabbis and monks partners to Allah in obedience and in ordaining the law. Other more common ways where ibadah is dismissed to Allah is ibadah is to know that the whole universe, everything in the universe, could not harm you if Allah didn't will it. To know that everything in the universe could not help you unless Allah willed it. Ibadah is not only salah, hajj, fast, and umrah, like many things, but your obedience to your parents is ibadah, just like hajj and umrah. Leaving riba and zina is also ibadah. Your love for Allah, your hate for Allah, your wala and bara, all that is included in ibadah. Today, something that when you leave the masjid, you leave Islam behind your back, at the doorsteps. And that's the thinking of a Jewish mentality and one of the reasons they went astray. أَفَتُؤْمِنُونَ بِبَعْضِ الْكِتَابِ وَتَكْفُرُونَ بَعْضِ. You believe in part of the scripture and you reject the rest. Allah reprimanded them, rebuked them for saying that or for doing that. The next point is, why did Allah order us to worship Him? Some today say, why do we worship Allah? Are you telling me this great creation, the universe with the human and the jinn and the animal and everything else in it, in the mountains and plains and everything that's created in it. Allah doesn't need us, as you say. But why do we worship? You tell us in a lecture that Allah doesn't benefit from our obedience and doesn't get harmed from our sin. He's independent, He's sovereign. But then you come up and say, you gotta worship. Why do we worship if He doesn't need us? First, rest assured and know for a fact that if the entire universe left ibadah, Allah is ghani. Wallahu al-ghani. He doesn't benefit from our obedience, nor does He get harmed from our sins. Keep that as a fact. His kingdom does not get more by the entire universe thanking and praising Him and glorifying Him. Nor does it become any less with the shirk of the mushrik or the sin and the slander of those who curse and slander Him by claiming that He has a son or in any other way or form. It doesn't become any less with that. In Sahih Muslim, the Hadith al-Qudsi, O my servants, you sin by night and by day and I am here to pardon your sins, therefore seek forgiveness from me so I may grant you pardon. O my servants, you can neither do me any harm, nor can you do me any good. O my servants, even if the first amongst you and the last amongst you and the whole human race of yours and that of the jinn came as pious as the most pious heart of anyone amongst you, it will not add anything to my power or my kingdom. O my servants, ya ibadi, If the first amongst you and the last amongst you and the whole human race and then the jinn tagged along with you and they became as wicked as the most wicked heart of anyone amongst you, would not decrease anything from my power or kingdom. It's all summed up in one verse. Ya ayyuhan nas antumul fuqara'u ila Allah wallahu wal ghaniyyul hamid. Mankind, it is you who stand in need of Allah. But Allah is rich, free of any needs. Allah is free of any needs, and Allah is worthy of our praise. There's two types of being poor or in need to Allah. The first one is the universal poverty or need to Allah. The biggest and strongest and wealthiest, most arrogant kafir is in poor need of Allah. He needs the sun. He needs the land, he needs the oxygen. This is called اضطراري, by force. وَلَهُ, in this, that's what's mentioned in this verse. وَلَهُ أَسْلَمَ مَنْ فِي السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ طَوْعًا وَكَرْهًا وَإِلَيْهِ يُرْجَعُونَ. To Him submitted all creations in the heaven, in the earth, willingly or unwillingly. They're in desperate need of Allah. The second one is faqr ikhtiyari, by choice. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to be amongst them. To have humility, reverence to Allah. The more you advance in your humility, in lowliness to Allah, the richer you become with Allah. Never, as we say many times, show arrogance in your ibadah. You're doing favors for yourself, not for Allah. وَلَهُ مَنْ فِي السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ وَمَنْ عِنْدَهُ لَا يَسْتَكْبِرُونَ عَنْ عِبَادَتِهِ وَلَا يَسْتَحْسِرُونَ in Surah Al-Anbiya. In Surah An-Nur. وَلَهُ مَنْ فِي السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ كُلٌّ لَهُ قَانِتُونَ. To him belong whatever's in the heaven, in the earth. And those angels who are near to him are not too proud to worship him, nor are they weary of his worship. If all human and jinn in the universe turn away from ibadah, the angels will continue to worship him, and he doesn't need the human, the jinn, nor the angels. Al-Bayt al-Ma'mur above the Kaaba, 70,000 enter there every day, never return until the judgment day. وَقَالَ مُوسَى إِن تَكْفُرُوا أَنْتُمْ وَمَنْ فِي الْأَرْضِ جَمِيعًا فَإِنَّ اللَّهَ لَغَنِيٌّ حَمِيدٌ. He told his people, if all of you disbelieve in Allah, Allah is independent. In many, many other verses like that in the Quran. إِن تَكْفُرُوا فَإِنَّ لِلَّهِ مَا فِي السَّمَاوَاتِ وَمَا فِي الْأَرْضِ وَكَانَ اللَّهُ غَنِيًّا حَمِيدًا. إِن تَكْفُرُوا فَإِنَّ اللَّهَ غَنِيٌّ عَنْكُمْ. All I mentioned so far is to show you how low me and you are to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. How desperate and poor we are to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. How we worship Him while we desperately need Him, He doesn't need us. Jalla fi ula. Now, let's answer the question. The wisdom behind us worshiping Allah, if He doesn't need us, and doesn't need our worship, nor does He need the jinn's worship, not even the angels' worship, does He need. Because first of all, Allah has a right over us. That's part of our belief in Allah, in His name, and in His qualities and attributes. He loves to be worshipped and glorified. You and me have to give Him His right over us. You find that kings in this world love matters and hate matters. Allah has the most supreme examples. وَلِلَّهِ الْمَثَلُ الْعَلَى. Allah loves that His slaves worship Him and glorify Him. Sahih Bukhari, Muslim, Hadith Mu'adh. كُنْتُ رَدِيفَ النَّبِي صلى الله عليه وسلم على حِمَارٍ فَقَالَ النَّبِي صلى الله عليه وسلم لِمُعَاذ يَا مُعَاذ قُتْ لَبَّيْكَ يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ وَسَعَدَيْكَ قَالَ تَدْرِي مَا حَقُّ اللَّهِ عَلَى الْعِبَادِ وَمَا حَقُّ الْعِبَادِ عَلَى اللَّهِ قَالَ مُعَاذ الله ورسوله أعلم. فقال صلى الله عليه وسلم حق الله على العباد أن يعبدوه ولا يشركوا به شيئا وحق العباد على الله ألا يعذب من لا يشرك به شيئا. قال معاذ قلت أفلا أبشر الناس يا رسول الله؟ قال لا تبشرهم فيتكلوا. فأخبر بها معاذ رضي الله عنه عند موته تأثما، أي خشية وقوعي في إثم لكتمان العلم عن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. In this long hadith, let's just take the point for this class. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم was teaching Mu'adh. Mu'adh was riding on a donkey with him, and the Prophet takes the time to teach him. And he was teaching him the right of Allah over us, and outrights Allah put upon himself that he will give us if we do the conditions that he tells us. The hadith Mu'adh never said to anyone except on his deathbed. And that's because the Prophet ﷺ told Mu'adh not to spread it for fear that it had so much hope in him that people may slack off on their deeds depending on the great hope that Allah gave us in this hadith. And the hadith is that Allah has a right upon us that we must worship Him without shirk. It's normal and not surprising that Allah has a right over us. That's normal. What's astonishing and amazing is for people to renegade against the right of Allah upon us. That's what's amazing. People do a small favor for you. And you never forget it for the rest of your life. I remember in Medina, in my last 4 months there, I had a teacher who taught me as a child, Quran. And when I returned to Medina, he was teaching in the Masjid al-Nabawi by Khawkhat Abu Bakr as-Siddiq, the doorway where the Prophet ﷺ said in his farewell words, close all the alleys leading to the masjid except my alley and Abu Bakr's alley. Khawkhati wa Khawkhat Abu Bakr as-Siddiq. It's still known till today. I was occupied in the university classes and plenty of private classes, and I didn't have time to go to him. In the last 4 months I had in Medina, I went to him to seek additional ijazah in the Quran. He told me, come back, and he took out a piece of paper, he wrote my name down, he said, come back and see me in 3 years if I'm still alive. I said, but Sheikh, and I'm only going to be in Medina 4 more months and I'm going to be done, inshallah, I'm going back to my country. And my father told me to get an ijazah from him no matter what it takes. He told me that ijazah from him, wallah, he said that, is more important to me than the degree you're going to get from the university. He had a high chain ijazah, and he was one of Al-Hudhayfi's teachers, and more importantly, he was among the best Quran teachers possibly of our time. Rahmatullah alayh. He said he can't do nothing. So then I got my father involved, and I told my father to call him. And that's how I got most of my private classes with many of the shuyukh there. He agreed. If his students agree, he told my father, if my students agree, then I will do it. Because everyone had a set time. And he asked them, would you be willing to, you know, take a little bit of time out so we can get Ahmed involved? And they all agreed, Jazahum Allah khair. It may be something simple, maybe something big. That was nearly 20 years ago. And I never forgot it. Nor did I forget what his students did when they all agreed to give me a portion of their time. And I make dua for him. For 20 years, I don't remember a day I don't make dua for him and them. Unless I forgot. And even recently, I was checking to send him a gift, very recently. And I found out that he died, rahmatullah alayhi, 3 years ago. So people who do a little bit of right, good for you, you cherish that from them. What about Allah? وَإِن تَعُدُّ نِعْمَةَ اللَّهِ لَا تُحْصُوهَا. You could never count Allah's blessings over you. You and yourself, you and your skull, and how it was perfected. Your eyes and your eyelids and your eyebrows. Your neck and your heart, وَفِي أَنفُسِكُمْ أَفَلَا تُبْصِرُونَ. You read about the eye and how it was slanted inwards in precision and perfection. And so no sweat, designed in so perfection that so no sweat will go in it. One of the doctors say that. I read it in an article once. Just go down from the top of your head to the bottom of your feet. Blessing after blessing that you couldn't count. That's just in yourself. وَفِي أَنفُسِكُمْ. So take it. All the blessings from the cradle to the grave, you couldn't count it. Leave everything and just look at the blessing of Islam. يَمُنُّونَ عَلَيْكَ أَنْ أَسْلَمُوا قُلْ لَا تَمُنُّوا عَلَيَّ أَسْلَامَكُمْ. It's a privilege from Allah. It's a mercy from Allah. So the first wisdom is that ibadah is a right of Allah upon us. It's His right over us. Second, ibadah is for us. We do it for Allah, but the benefit's really for us, not for Allah. Allah's Rahim, the quality we mentioned to Allah, the most merciful. Allah sent down to His entire creation, from the beginning of the creation to the end, one of His mercies. And He saved 99 for the judgment day. He's a Rahim. He's a Rahman. He's a Rahim. From the biggest aspects of His rahmah is that He allowed us and taught us to worship Him. Ibadah is nourishing to the soul and to the heart. Your body and soul both need food to survive. Your physical body, you need air. You need water. You need food to sustain it and nourish it. Your spiritual soul screams for needs as well. And that need is ibadah. It'll be fulfilled with ibadah. Only Allah knows the details of the soul. Therefore, its food and nourishment is prescribed by Allah through His messengers, alayhim salatu wasalam. No way can we live without it. Without ibadah, the hearts rust like metal. They wear out like clothes. You spray the rust off by ibadah. You refurbish the heart by ibadah. Ibadah is means to take away your problems. So the benefit's for you. It brings you nearer to Allah. So the benefit's yours. Every aspect of ibadah, there's a benefit for you in it. And every sin, there's harm for you in it. You're the one benefiting from it. And the verses by that are many in the Quran. مَنْ عَمِلَ صَالِحًا فَلِنَسِّهِ. You do good, it's for you. وَمَنْ أَسَاءَ فَعَلَيْهَا وَمَا رَبُّكَ بِظَلَّامِ لِلْعَبِيدِ. For you, فَلِنَسِّهِ. You're doing it for yourself. وَمَنْ شَكَرَ فَإِنَّمَا يَشْكُرُ لِنَفْسِهِ وَمَنْ كَفَرَ فَإِنَّ رَبِّي غَنِيٌّ كَرِيمٌ. You're thinking for your own good. It's only for your own good. You worship Him because you're in desperate need from Him. That's another wisdom. أَمَّنْ يَهْدِيكُمْ فِي ظُلُمَاتِ الْبَرِّ وَالْبَحْرِ وَمَنْ يُرْسِلُ الرِّيَاحَ بُشْرًا بَيْنَ يَدَيْ رَحْمَتِهِ أَإِلَهٌ مَعَ اللَّهِ تَعَالَى اللَّهُ عَمَّا يُشْرِكُونَ أَمَّنْ يَبْدَأُ الْخَلْقَ ثُمَّ يُعِيدُهُ وَمَنْ يَرْزُقُكُمْ مِنَ السَّمَاءِ وَالْأَرْضِ أَإِلَهٌ مَعَ اللَّهِ قُلْ هَاتُوا بُرْهَانَكُمْ إِنْ كُنْتُمْ صَادِقِينَ أَمَّنْ يُجِيبُ الْمُضْطَرَّ إِذَا دَعَاهُ وَيَكْشِفُ السُّوءَ وَيَجْعَلُكُمْ خُلَفَاءَ الْأَرْضِ أَإِلَهٌ مَعَ اللَّهِ قَلِيلًا مَا تَذَكَّرُونَ أمن يهديكم في ظلمات البر والبحر ومن يرسل الرياح بشرا بين يدي رحمته أإله مع الله تعالى الله عما يشركون. Your worship Allah is an honor for you. For you. It's the benefits for you. You honor yourself by being a slave of the creator of the universe. Because when you become a slave of Allah and worship Him, you're not a slave for anything else. Ibadah is to benefit you and not Allah. يا أيها الناس اعبدوا ربكم الذين خلق الذي خلقكم والذين من قبلكم لعلكم تتقون. Says here, your benefit is taqwa from your worship. لعلكم تتقون. اتلوا ما أوحي إليك من الكتاب وأقم الصلاة إن الصلاة تنهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر. Your ibadah, your salah benefits you because it deters you from disbelief, polytheism, and every evil, wicked deed and even bad manners. خذ من أموالهم صدقة تطهرهم وتزكيهم بها وصلي عليهم إن صلاتك سكن لهم من سورة التوبة. Your عبادة of zakah is to purify and sanctify you. You. Us. For us. Your عبادة is a right of Allah upon you. The next statement. أن تعبد الله وحده مخلصا له الدين. Making religion purely and sincerely for Him. Let's stop here, inshallah. We will continue next week. وجزاكم الله خير وصلى الله على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله.